Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Holver Alley Crew, a Streets of Maradaine novel by Marshall Ryan Maresca, narrated by Dan Calley. Chapter 1. Asti Rynax couldn't sleep. The bedroll wasn't the problem. He'd spent plenty of nights in jail cells, road ditches, even trapped inside a wooden crate. The problem was sleeping on a hot wooden floor in the single-room flop, his younger brother, brother's wife and crying baby just 10 feet away behind a thin cloth. He craved his own flop, his own space, without families, babies or smoke. Smoke. Asti sat up, smelling the air. Definitely smoke. And not from the oil lamps. Asti sprang to his feet.
Verci, wake up.
What? What is it?
Smoke.
Verci was out of the bed, crossing over to Asti in a flash, despite being naked. Asti's eyes went to the slight paunch his brother was getting. Married life was taking its toll on his normally lean body.
You're right.
It's just the Greenfields kitchen,
Rach mumbled from the bed.
No, it's too strong,
Asti said. He glanced back at Verci.
Put something on.
Verci waved him off, taking another smell.
That's too strong.
Asti touched the door. It was warm. Cautiously, he cracked it open. The hallway glowed with crackling flames. He dashed back over to the kitchen and grabbed the bedroll and blanket.
Blasted saints,
Verci muttered.
Rach, wake up.
What?
Get up. Get the baby.
Each word was like an arrow. Verci grabbed his pants off the back of a chair and pulled them on. Asti held the blanket over his face. In the hallway, the flames were licking up the walls and ceiling, wooden support beams already cracking. Asti swung the bedroll at the fire, beating it down. Useless. The smoke was getting thicker, the fire hotter, despite his efforts.
Can you get to the stairs?
Verci called. Asti pushed forward. The stairs leading outside were only 8 steps away. 8 impossible steps. He could race past the fire to reach them if he went right this moment. The stairway was engulfed, but he could leap down the flight. He would reach the bottom with a few singes and roll on the ground when he landed, snuffing out his clothes if they caught flame on the way down. He could do it and be outside and safe in 7 seconds. He imagined the whole plan in an instant, his body tensing in anticipation. Verci could do it too if he called out, told him to run, to go now. Rach and the baby could never make it. He beat down the instinct to run.
No chance,
Asti replied. The fire filled the hallway, racing along to block him from the apartment door. Lungs and eyes burning, he beat a clear path back and slammed the door shut.
How bad is it?
Rach asked. She was out of bed, wrapped in a loose dressing gown, caramel hair framing her pretty face, with the baby clutched to her. Asti could barely speak through hacking coughs.
Very,
was all he managed. He shoved the bedroll under the crack in the door, blocking the smoke that was starting to pour in.
How are we going to get out then?
She asked. Her voice cracked with fear. Asti didn't answer, but he heard a slight snort from his brother. Verci covered it with a cough, but Asti knew exactly why he laughed. Verci never walked into a room without immediately finding every way to get out. Verci went over to the trunk by the bed and opened it up. While he rummaged through it, Asti pulled on a shirt and boots and grabbed his pack. Everything in the apartment that he owned was in the pack.
Plan?
He asked Verci.
That window,
Verci said, pointing to the one by the stove.
But not yet.
He pulled out an empty pack from the trunk.
Verci, what are we?
Rach started. Verci tossed the empty pack to Asti as he went over to Rach.
Give me coffee and get dressed, he said. We have to move quickly.
Quickly?
She looked stunned, but relinquished the baby to Verci.
Put that on, Asti,
Verci said, crossing over to the kitchen with the baby.
Wear it across your chest.
Asti did it, and Verci put his son into the pack. He tightened the straps on the side so the baby was snug, close against Asti's body.
Verci Rynax, what the blazes are you doing?
Rach asked, pulling on a cotton dress.
Keeping our son safe, Verci said.
He turned to Asti.
Get the window open and get out there.
If you think I'm going to let my baby...
Verci went back to the trunk.
We need to climb down from the window, Rach. You can't do that while carrying him. He pulled on a shirt and grabbed another pack.
Then you carry him.
I'll be helping you, love, Verci said. He threw a few more things into the pack. Smoke was filling the room. No time to argue. Asti went out the window. There was a slight ledge, only a few inches, just enough for him to stand on. Above him, there was only smoke and darkness. He knew both moons were roughly half full, but he couldn't see them. The street below was chaotic, people shouting and pointing, running around in their nightclothes while the fire crackled all around. Directly below him was the canvas awning of Greenfield's locksmith shop, stretched wide and tight.
Awning, slide, street?
Asti called to Verci.
Right, Verci said. Move.
Hold on, little man, Asti said, rubbing the head of the baby. For his part, he was quiet, his big blue eyes staring up at Asti. Asti sat down on the ledge, his feet a short drop from the top of the awning. Keeping one hand on the ledge, he dropped off, using his arm to keep his full weight from hitting the awning. Once his body was on the canvas, he let go, sliding down over the lip of it. A second later, his boots hit the dirt. He stumbled forward, almost needing to fall into a roll, but he clutched at the baby and lurched backward, keeping his balance. Several people on the street cried and cheered. Up on the ledge, Rach cried,
I'm going to break my neck if I do that.
No, you won't, Verci said. Asti looked back at the building. The whole place was on fire, smoke pouring out the windows. Verci lowered his wife onto the awning. Her eyes were locked on Asti, focused on the bundle strapped to his chest. Asti looked at the baby again, who was gurgling and smiling.
He's fine, Rach, come on.
Asti held out a hand, though he knew it was a meaningless gesture. Verci stretched out, easing Rach down the awning until she was as far as he could get her without stepping on the awning himself.
Ready?
Verci called.
Do it,
she said. He let go of her hand and she slid off to the ground. Her landing was sloppy, almost falling on her face before Asti caught her. Rach gasped and clutched at Asti. A moment later, she was fumbling at the straps, desperate to get the baby out of his pack. Verci slid down, landing on the ground with practiced grace.
That's the whole place, Asti said.
The locksmith shop and the apartments above it were all burning. The shop next door was burning as well, and the one next to it. The fire spread down Holver Alley as far as Asti could see. Every building was wood and plaster, pressed next to each other, nothing to stop it all from catching. An old man grabbed Asti's shoulder.
Look at that, Rynax. That's magic fire, isn't it? Has to be.
No, no, he said,
coming up with an answer that was somewhere between fabrication and gut instinct.
Magical fire always burns hotter with blue and white flames.
Asti knew hardly anything about magic, but that was more than anyone else in Holver Alley. His word might be enough to quell wild rumours about mages starting this.
Where's Wynne?
Verci asked, looking around the crowd.
And the girls?
Asti glanced about. Winthim Greenfield wasn't anywhere, nor were his wife and daughters.
Did they get out on the other side?
Rach asked, holding her baby close to her chest.
No chance, Verci said.
Asti knew the question was ridiculous, but bit his tongue. Greenfield's shop was built right up against a solid brick wall, the back of the row houses on Kenner Street.
They must be trapped, Asti said.
The shop windows were dark, covered in iron bars. No way to see in or break through. Asti touched the door of the shop. It was still cool.
Asti, what are you doing?
Rach cried. Asti tried the door, but it was locked. Of course it would be.
Verci, can you?
He called out, but his brother was already at his side. Verci looked at the lock carefully.
Wind's very good, he muttered. It would take me at least 5 minutes.
No time for that,
Asti said. He scanned the crowd. Rach was in the center of his vision, screaming at them. Far behind her, towering over the crowd, was just the person he was hoping to find. Julian Kesser, the biggest bruiser on Holver Alley.
Julian, he called.
The big man pushed his way through the crowd, Asti meeting him partway.
You all right, Jules? Your house all right?
No,
Julian said, his wide, sad face covered in ash and soot.
I'm sorry, Julian, Asti said. Wynne Grimfield and his family are still trapped.
Julian nodded and charged without further prodding. Verci scrambled out of the way as Julian smashed his shoulder into the door. It splintered and cracked.
Asti Rynax, what in the name of the blasted saints do you think you're doing?
Helene Kesser, Julian's cousin, had come up right behind him, grabbing his wrist tightly. Her face and nightclothes were covered in ashes, black hair a tangled mess, and bare arms scraped and bleeding.
I barely got Jules out of our house. Don't you dare have him.
I just need the door open, Asti said.
He glanced over at Rach, still crying at Verci to come away from the burning building.
Keep everyone else out, Hel, especially Verci. How the blazes?
Just do it, Asti said.
He took off his pack and handed it to Helen. Without another word, he pulled a cloak out and took it to the well spigot nearest Greenfield's shop. He pumped it hard, but only a trickle of water came out. While he was doing that, Julian broke the door off its hinges with a loud crunch. Smoke poured out through the open frame. Asti took a deep breath, put on the damp cloak, and ran into the shop. He could hear Helen yelling from outside, telling Julian not to go in after him. Asti couldn't see anything. Thick smoke filled the shop. Eyes shut, cloak over his face, he went by memory to the back counter. He didn't need to see to find his way. It was 5 steps straight and then 3 to the right to the door leading to Wynne's workshop.
Wynne, he called out.
He could barely hear his own voice over the roar of fire. Blindly, he found the door to the back room and gave a silent prayer that it would be unlocked. He pushed his way in and tripped over something on the ground. The fire blazed throughout the workshop, but on the floor, the smoke was thinner. He had tripped over Greenfield's body. Winthim lay flat on his face, breathing shallowly. Asti shook him.
Wynne, come on.
Asti shook him again, but he didn't wake. Through the smoke, a hand touched Asti on the shoulder. Verci came crawling in, stopping right in front of Wynne's body.
What are you doing?
Asti shouted at his brother.
Same as you,
Verci said. The ceiling crackled and creaked above them.
Fine, you get him out, I'll...
You're nothing.
Verci pointed at the stairway to the Greenfields' rooms, blocked by the fire.
You can't get up there.
Get him out, maybe I can...
He got to his feet.
There's no chance, Asti.
Verci yanked him back down. A moment later, the ceiling came crashing down in the middle of the workroom, bringing fresh flames from above. One timber knocked Asti on the arm. Verci grabbed the damp cloak and beat out the fire on Asti's sleeve.
We can't leave them,
Asti shouted over the screaming blaze.
No one is alive up there. We need to get out now.
But help me.
Verci draped Wynne over his shoulder and Asti did the same on the other side. They traced the steps through the black smoke back out to the street. Julian came over and took Greenfield from them. They all hurried away from the blaze, dropping to their knees once they were clear. Asti took several deep breaths of sweet, cool air, while Verci hacked and wheezed next to him.
Verci Rynax, how dare you?
Rach started.
I'm fine, Rach, Verci said, even if his cough belied that.
He reached up and cupped her face tenderly. Her eyes welled up with tears.
You are not fine. That was a stupid, reckless...
I'm fine as well, you know,
Asti said. He left his brother and went to where Julian had laid Greenfield on the ground. Asti knelt down and touched Wynne's head and chest.
What do you think, Rynax?
Helen said, hovering over him.
He'll probably have a blazes of a cough, but I think he'll live,
Asti said. He looked back up. Every shop and house on the east side of Holver Alley was on fire now. Their shop was on the east side.
Where is the blasted fire brigade?
Asti muttered.
Don't know, Helen said. Don't think we can count on them now, can we?
Right, Asti said. The crowd stood staring at the fire, people screaming or crying, but no one doing a blasted thing.
Julian, take Wynne to Kimber's pub over on Frost. Doc Gelson is usually deep in the cider over there all night. Hell, don't think you can order me and my cousin around, Rynax,
Helen said, emphasizing her point by shoving his pack back in his hands.
I'm not ordering, Helen, Asti snapped at her. I'm asking for help. Asking sounds a lot different. Blasted damn saints, hell. The whole alley is burning down.
Asti's guts were churning. He fought down the bile, forcing its way up his throat. Helen grit her teeth.
What you want, Rynax?
Get people away from the fire,
he said. Make sure Rach goes.
I'm not going to be your blasted running girl, Asti, Helen said. You know I'm worth more than that.
I know, Asti said, but I don't need you putting an arrow in anyone tonight. Not yet, anyhow.
Right, Helen said.
Julian had wind picked up in his massive arms, looking to his cousin for her cue.
If you do, though, she let it hang there.
Wouldn't call on anyone else.
Helen nodded and went into the crowd, telling people to head over to Frost. People started shuffling away. Asti went back to Verci and Rach.
Rach, get out of here. Go over to your sister's, Asti said.
Come on, brother.
Where are you going?
She asked him, grabbing her husband by the arm.
We've got a shop down on the other end, in case you forgot, Asti said.
Verci nodded, touching Rach's hand.
Every crown we have is put in there.
Right,
she said, resigned. She glanced back over to the locksmith's shop, now completely ablaze.
Don't do anything else so stupid as that, though.
I'll do all the stupid things, Asti said.
Come on. He raced down the alley. His brother was right at his heels. He didn't need to look behind to know. He could feel it. Holver Alley was a quarter mile long. If Asti ran full tilt, he could cross it in a minute. With the panicked crowd, the flames, the choking smoke, Asti had to fight for every step. Every shop, every home, every building on the east side of the alley was on fire. Asti almost tripped over Mrs. Hoskins, who sat on the dirt with her grandchildren, all wailing and screaming while their house burned. Jared School, the butcher, was held back by three others while he desperately clawed towards his shop and house. His children were nowhere to be seen. A dark-haired street girl stood in the middle of the road, staring blankly up at the conflagration.
Asti, Verci shouted.
He pointed to a wrought iron balcony three flights up. Hexie Matlin, the crazy fortune teller, trembled with her little dog clutched to her chest. The fire raged inside her flop, trapping her. She cried out for help, panic cracking her voice.
We have to go, Asti started.
Asti,
Verci didn't need to say anything else. It was all in his face. Hexie had been a good friend to their mother. They had known her all their lives.
Fine, Asti said.
But I promised your wife I'd do the stupid things.
I'm the better climber, Verci said.
Then figure out how I'm getting her down.
Asti gave a quick point up to Hexie's balcony and then to the barbershop on the other side of the alley. With two quick bounds, he was up on the doorframe of the barbershop and then scrambling up the windows, finding whatever handholds he could. He reached the roof 40 feet above the alley. From up here, he would normally be able to see most of the city of Maradaine, or at least the west side. But now smoke filled his vision, obscuring even the view of the North Selleth neighbourhood. He could still see the alley below, the balcony across, and Hexie's panicked face. Verci came up over the edge of the roof, quickly getting his pack off.
I told you to stay down there.
You told me to not do anything stupid.
He pulled out a rope and a gear and pulley device from the pack.
Trust me, I'm leaving that to you.
He tossed one end of the rope to Asti.
What's the plan?
Asti asked.
You know damn well what the plan is, Verci said. Like the gig for Tolman 5 years ago.
Right.
Asti hated that gig. He tied the rope around his waist and dropped his pack. He darted over to the far end of the roof.
This is the dumbest thing I've done in a long time.
At least a month, Verci said.
He held on to his end of the rope.
Go.
Asti dashed across the roof and leaped off, sailing across the alley. A second later, he crashed onto the balcony next to Hexie's.
You missed,
Verci shouted from the rooftop.
Shut it.
Asti climbed up on the rail of his balcony, the metal creaking under him. He jumped the few feet over to Hexie, who screamed when he landed. The balcony shuddered with his weight.
Get me out of here,
she cried.
That's the plan,
he said, untying the rope from his waist. The balcony buckled again.
Hurry,
she clutched her dog tighter.
I really am going as fast as I can, he said.
He stood behind her, wrapping the rope around the both of them as he held her tight.
Now, Asti.
Yes, ma'am,
he said. A loud crack came from behind them and the balcony came loose on one side. The two of them lurched and Hexie screamed again. Asti saw Verci working frantically with his device. He threaded the rope through it and then corded around his waist.
Blessed saints, forgive me my sins,
Hexy cried. You think you'd have seen this coming, Hexy? Asti said. He wrapped his arms around her. The rope pulled taut from Verci cranking the gears on his device.
I couldn't,
Hexy stammered out. The balcony was about to give way. No more time. Verci, now, Asti shouted, and he jumped. The balcony collapsed, crashing down to the alley below, onlookers scattering to avoid being crushed. Verci jumped over the ledge at the same time. He drifted down while Asti and Hexy shot up, flying across the alley. Asti braced himself, both feet hitting the brick wall of the building with a hard sting. Hexy and her dog both cried out, but they seemed unhurt.
Oh, blessed saints,
Hexy whispered. Asti looked down to the ground. Verci started uncoiling the rope, controlling Asti and Hexy's descent. His hands worked quickly, his arms straining, until they reached the ground safely. As soon as their feet made contact, Asti let her go, untying the rope around them. She collapsed to the ground, still giving prayers, her little dog running in crazy circles around her.
Catch it worked this time, Asti said as he freed himself from the rope.
Of course it did, Verci swiped back. He bent over Hexy. Safe and sound, Mrs. Matlin.
Thank you, blessed saints,
she said.
Oh, thank you, boys. Your mother would be so proud of you.
It was nothing, Verci said with a smile.
It was nothing for you, Asti said, elbowing his brother in the ribs.
You promised to do the stupid things, Verci said.
Stupid promise, Asti muttered. You're all right now, Hexy. We have to check our shop.
I'm fine, boys,
she said unconvincingly. She looked around at the fire and madness surrounding them.
Our packs are still on the roof, Verci said.
Later, Asti muttered. He grabbed Versi's arm and pulled him down the alley. The Rynax Gadgetarium hadn't even opened yet. Not one customer, not one sale. They had bought the shop less than a month ago and had been working on getting it fixed up enough to open. They had put down most every crown they had to buy the place from old Spence, but they still owed him quite a bit of silver. It wasn't a great bargain, but it was better than owing money to one of the ankle breakers in Keller Cove. Old Spence had let the place become a wreck, and it had taken a lot of work on their part to make it presentable. Asti had figured it would only be a couple more days before they could open. The flops above the store were still unlivable, but when the shop was open, they planned to clean and fix them so they could move in. The Rynax Gadgetarium was nothing but a burning husk now, a handful of beams and stones in the rough skeleton of a building, the sad corpse of their plans. Verci stood agape in front of what had been their shop, not moving an inch as he stared at the smouldering remnants. Asti's blood boiled, a rush of mixed emotions, rage winning. It took a moment for Asti to realize there was a cry from inside Alma Court's chemist shop across the street from the Gadgetarium. Court's shop wasn't burning, but the door was broken open. Asti ran inside. Five young toughs were in the shop. Two of them held Court up against the wall, working him over. The other three were rifling through the shop, knocking over shelves and glass bottles.
Where's your lockbox?
One of them shouted. Asti charged right in at the two boys holding on to Court. His building rage finally had a target, five stupid faces for him to hit. He launched at the one he figured to be the leader of this gang, grabbing the hooligan about the waist and ripping him away from Court. That one dealt with for the moment. He kicked the other one in the knee. Run, Asti shouted to Court, who was still up against the wall, gasping for breath. Court managed to stumble to the door of his back room. Asti turned to the hooligans. Just a glance was all he needed to figure this bunch out. Street scrappers, every one. No real training. The closest two had knives. The other three, back by the shelves, didn't have any obvious weapons. Asti knew he didn't look too intimidating, given his short stature and wiry frame. If it wasn't for the layer of unshaven scruff on his face, they might think he was just a kid. Still, they hung back, each one waiting for someone else to pounce. Asti didn't give them a chance. Since he was unarmed, he went for the closest one, the one with two knives. Asti needed those knives. The kid held his guard up, tried to slash at Asti. Wasn't fast enough. And Asti dove in, taking the cuts on his arms. He gave two sharp punches at the kid's shoulders. Before the others could react, Asti grabbed him by the wrists and spun him around. The knives clattered to the ground. Asti was about to push the kid at the other armed one. Before he could, the hooligan swung back his head, cracking Asti's nose. Everything went red. Chapter 2. Verci didn't know how long he stood staring at the smouldering remains of his shop. He couldn't even wrap his head around what was lost. Tools, inventions, every crown they owned, every ounce of work they had put into it, all gone. Screams from Court's shop snapped Verci out of his reverie. Three boys ran out of the shop screaming. They ran like they were on fire. They ran like death was after them. Asti wasn't next to him anymore. Verci hadn't noticed him leave. "Asti," Verci whispered, racing into the shop. Shelves were knocked over, bottles broken. The place was a wreck. A street boy was dead on the floor, two knives buried in his chest. Asti was on top of another one, pinning him to the ground with his knees while pummeling his face. There was no struggle, no resistance, just his brother pounding his fists into a senseless mass of blood and meat. Verci grabbed Asti's shoulder. Asti reacted instantly, spinning around and grabbing Verci by the throat. His face was twisted, covered in blood and ash, his eyes burning with empty rage. Verci clawed at his brother's hand, trying to get it free of his neck. Asti lifted him up off the ground. "As," was all Verci could gasp out. He battered at Asti's head, a futile effort. Asti wasn't letting go. Verci was about to black out. A hand appeared from nowhere and smeared a paste under Asti's nose. A moment later, Asti went limp and crumpled to the ground. Verci managed to land on his feet, woozy but stable. Alma Court was standing there, a small man with a thick, graying beard and wide spectacles. He wiped off his finger on the front of his leather apron. "You all right?" Court asked. Schooling had blunted his West Maradaine accent, but not eliminated it. "Think so," Verci said. "How long will he be out?" "A few minutes." Court pulled out a handkerchief and wiped the gunk from Asti's face. "Shouldn't leave it there very long, though." "What happened?" "Some rats cracked into my shop," Court said. "They were roughing me up when he came in and..." Court looked at the two dead bodies on the floor of the shop. He just went crazy on them." "Yeah," Verci shook his head. "Blazes. Not again. Asti had been getting better. Not like this could make anyone snap." "Court ought to buy that." "What's happening out there?" Court asked. "Fire," Verci said. "The whole east side of the alley."
"Fire brigade?"
"Haven't seen them yet," Verci said. "It's insane out there."
"It's insane in here," Court said, looking down at Asti. "He going to go berserk when he comes to?"
"No," said it too quick. "Too suspicious. I don't think so, at any rate."
Court picked up another bottle. "He gets this in his face if he does."
"He'll be fine," Verci snapped. "Think you can do something about the fire?"
Court looked around at the broken shelves. "Nothing on a large scale. This building should be safe if the fire jumps across. Solid brick."
"Small comfort," Verci said. Asti groaned and stirred. "Hey, brother, you all right?"
Asti woke with a startled jerk. Eyes bulging, he clutched out and grabbed Versi's shirt.
"Verci," he said, looking around.
"Where are we?"
"Court's shop," Verci said.
"When did we..."
Asti looked at his hands, covered with blood.
"Did I..."
He faltered, looking back at Verci.
"You did," Verci said. "Some street rats were hurting Alma, and you got rid of them."
"Not all of them,"
Asti said. The mutilated bodies were still lying on the ground near them. He sat up, burying his face in his hands.
"Places, brother. I don't know if I can go through this again."
"It's all right, Asti," Verci said, crouching down. "It's been a crazy night. Anyone could lose it, right? Anyone."
He signalled in Court's direction with his eyes. Asti didn't care.
"There's two dead bodies here, Verci. What are we going to do about that when constabulary comes?"
"I can take care of that," Court offered. He opened up one bottle and poured a light powder on top of the two bodies. They both started sizzling, the flesh burning away.
"We've got half the alley burning down. I can slip them into one of the burned buildings.
Constabs won't be looking too hard at two more corpses in this mess.
This mess is our homes, our businesses, Alma, Asti snapped. Friends, lives.
I know that. Court stalked over to the door, looking out at the wreckage across the street.
And snots like these boys tried to take advantage. You took care of it, Asti. I'm not going to let you take a hit, get sent over to Quarry Gate or something for helping me. Least I can do.
We appreciate it, Alma, Verci said.
Court pulled on some heavy gloves and dragged the first body out of the shop. Asti paced about, hands clenched in tight fists.
Not again, Verci. I can't...
Don't say that. He took Asti by the shoulders. Don't you dare tell me you can't.
Asti shook his head, looking at the ground.
I'm not any better. It's still cracking.
Look at me.
Verci grabbed his brother's head, forcing him to meet his eyes. He'd be damned if he let Asti slip off on him now. Not in the middle of this.
Job ain't over, and we're skunked. You hear me?
Job ain't skunked until you're pinched or dead,
Asti whispered. One of Dad's rules.
Are we pinched? Verci asked.
No.
Dead?
Not yet.
A hint of a smile crossed Asti's lips. Then we drive forward, hmm?
Forward.
Asti nodded and stepped away. Now his chin was high, eyes full of thought. He stripped out of his bloody clothes, throwing them on the remaining body.
Where's my pack?
Still up on that roof.
Go get them, Asti said. I need fresh clothes.
Good, Verci said. He went to the door. Tell me you have a plan.
I always have a plan, brother.
And what's that?
We're going to see the old lady.
There were no lamps burning in the windows of the Junk Avenue bakery. Several blocks away from Holver Alley, it was a quiet night. No panic in the street, hardly any stirring at all. The only sound was Asti pounding on the bakery door.
She's probably asleep, Verci said.
He didn't want to do this, not in the middle of the night, not without checking on Rach first. Asti insisted, though, his mind whirring like a clockwork box again. Verci would go all night if it kept Asti on this side of sanity. Asti shook his head.
The question is if she's here at all tonight.
She's here, Verci said.
He didn't have his ear to the ground like he used to, but if she had gone somewhere else, he probably would have heard about it.
Question is if she'll see us.
She will.
She never liked that you left, Verci said.
Asti shrugged.
She'll still see us. She likes you.
He pounded the door again. After a moment, it creaked open a crack. A small man looked out through the crack.
What do you want? It's the middle of the night.
We need the old lady, Asti said. Is she here?
I don't know what you mean.
Oh, come off it, Mersh, Verci said. Look at us, it's Asti and Verci Rynax.
The man peered closer.
Sorry, couldn't see you, he added pointedly. It's dark, it being the middle of the night when you came banging.
He opened the door and let them in. Been a while since you've been here. Verci looked around the bakery as Mersh went about lighting lamps. He hadn't been in the place for over a year. The place still smelled the same as it had a year ago, when he did that last job for her, a lifetime ago.
He said, you look awful, Mersh said once he had a light on. What happened?
The whole alley burned down tonight.
What? Said Mersh. What do you mean? Which alley?
Holver Alley, every single shop and house on the east side, said Asti. From Ullen Street to Rabbit.
Great blessed saints, said Mersh. How? Is anyone hurt, or...
He let it hang. A lot of people dead, Mersh, Asti snarled.
We don't know all what happened yet, Verci said. Stay awake and start baking, though. There's a few more hungry people with no homes out there today.
Mersh kissed his knuckle and pressed it to his forehead, whispering a quick prayer. Three knocks pounded from below the shop. Mersh went over by the oven and twisted a few hidden levers. A small trap door opened in the wall by the counter.
Sounds like she'll see you. Go on down.
Asti crouched to enter the hatch.
Boys, leave the packs and any weapons.
Right,
Asti said, sliding the pack off his shoulders and handing it over to Mersh. He crawled down the hatch. Verci slid his own pack off, grabbed a lamp and followed him. The passage was a narrow staircase, the ceiling not more than 5 feet high. The two of them needed to crouch low to work their way down, one step at a time. As soon as they were both going down, the hatch door shut behind them.
How the blazes does she get down this way? Asti asked.
I don't think this is the way she takes, Verci said. I've never gone down this way. A sudden sense of dread filled him. Asti, stop.
What is it?
Asti asked. He put his foot down on the next step, and as he did it, Verci heard a gentle click. Asti looked up at Verci.
Oh, sweet blasted saint, is this what I think it is?
Stay perfectly still, Asti.
She blasted well had us sent down a blazing trapped staircase, Asti shouted. Played us for rabbits.
Shush, Verci hissed. Slowly he moved down to the step above Asti's and handed him the lamp. I think it's an arm and release. We'll be all right, as long as you don't move.
And what will happen if I do?
Verci gently touched the step. There was just a hint of quiver to it, barely noticeable. He reached down to the next step and touched it. No quiver, no give. It was stable. Stretching around Asti, he moved down to it.
Blazes you doing?
Getting a better view, Verci said. Don't move.
Don't knock me over.
Verci got on the lower step and crouched down to Asti's feet. The steps were wooden, and Asti's had two small grooves in the back that allowed it to slide down the quarter inch it needed to arm the trap.
What will it do when it goes off, Verci?
Working on that, Verci said. He could feel a slight vibration somewhere near him. He touched the wall. That was the source. He ran his fingers down to the base where the wall met the steps. Sure enough, there was just a slight gap, a hint of a draft coming from the crack.
This wall will close in on us.
We're going to be crushed. Asti started swearing profusely. Verci looked along the wood grain of the step. There were slight scrapes, ending two-thirds of the way across.
No, it doesn't close completely. We'll just be pinned, a few broken bones.
Slow or fast? Verci placed his hand back on the wall. I'm thinking this is being held back by tension. Its natural position is to be closed in. I think it'll slam on us.
It's going to kill that blasted doxy, Asti said.
Just stay still, Verci said. He tapped along the back of the steps. Hollow. He took off his shirt and wrapped it around one hand.
What are you doing?
Don't have many tools, Verci said. Have to get into the guts of this trap somehow. He punched into the back wall of the step.
St. Keller, Asti shouted. Won't that set it off?
Hope not.
Hope not.
Verci punched again. The wood cracked. The panel on the back step wasn't very thick. Verci punched again. The panel gave way enough to get a few fingers inside it. He unwrapped his hand and pried the panel off. Hand me the lamp.
Do you know what you're doing?
No, you're just insulting me. The device was not very complicated. It armed when Asti's weight snapped a small pin holding the release trigger in place. Once he moved off the stair, there would be nothing to prevent the trigger from closing, and that would slam the wall on them both.
There must be a lot of counterweights in here somewhere to balance this out.
That's really fascinating, brother.
What can you do?
Take off your belt.
Why my belt?
Because I'm not wearing one. Asti started removing his belt.
Verci, I really feel I have to tell you something.
Please don't get sentimental on me, brother, Verci said.
I'm not, Asti said.
He handed Verci the belt. I want to tell you that far too many of your plans involve removing clothing.
You love it.
Yes, very much. Verci pulled off the belt buckle. It was a crude tool, but it would do the job. Get ready.
To do what?
Very slowly, you're going to remove your weight from the step, and I'm going to wedge the belt buckle into the trigger.
This is your plan.
This is the plan.
I hate your plan.
Good, Verci said. He got the buckle in position. Count of five.
Do I remove on five, or is a five count the pace of taking my weight off?
Surprise me, Verci said. One. Asti lifted himself up, the step moving just a hair. Two. Three. Four. The step moved up a bit more, and Verci pushed the buckle into the trigger. Five. Asti was off the step. The trigger held.
All right, let's go, Asti said.
Up or down?
Down, Asti said. We go through that. We're going to see the old lady.
They went down the last few steps carefully, making sure that nothing else was rigged. The door at the bottom of the steps had no handle.
Fake door. A staircase to nowhere,
Asti asked. Verci knocked on it.
Hollow.
There's empty space back there. Just don't know what.
What do you think?
I think that belt buckle isn't going to hold forever, and we want to get out of this stairwell.
Good thought. Stand back,
Asti said. He braced his hands on the sides of the wall and hit the door with a sharp kick. It came right off the frame.
He's enough?
A little crude, though.
The old lady's voice came from the next room.
Come in, boys.
The room was a small study, warmly lit with several lamps and candles. Verci hated this room. There were no obvious exits, save the broken door they just came through. He couldn't even spot the entrance he had always used in the past. The old lady made every way in and out a hidden passage. Verci darted his eyes about, trying to determine what in the room could be a secret lever, a hidden catch, anything that would open the way out. Knowing her, there was a good chance any door he found would lead to a trapped dead end. There were several soft chairs at a round table. The table was covered in loose papers. The old lady, Mrs. Josephine Holt, was sitting at the table. Slowly, she gathered up some of the papers and put them in a neat pile.
Sit down,
she said. She stood up from her chair, picking up a cane and using it to support herself as she crossed over to a metal pipe. She banged it twice with the cane and pulled a lever next to it. She looked much older than she had a year ago. Her curly bush of hair had gone from dark brown with a few single greys to having large streaks of white. Her clothes were simple, modest cotton blouse, practical wool skirt, no jewellery or other adornments. No one glancing at her would suspect she was one of the richest people in the North Selleth neighbourhood. She was stooped slightly, as if she was carrying a heavy weight. Verci knew she had been reliant on the cane for years, but now it seemed far more necessary than ever before. It almost broke his heart to see her like this. Almost.
Why did you try and kill us? He asked.
Asti, he could tell, was steaming, too angry to speak yet.
Please, Verci, she said as she returned to the table. If that little thing had killed you, then you wouldn't be worth talking to anyway. And put your shirt on.
So that's why you sent us down that way? Verci asked as he dressed. See if I still had the goods to get through a trap like that.
I'm disappointed that you triggered it at all, frankly.
So am I, Verci said. Careless and amateur.
You do that on a real job, you'd get pegged for sure.
Real job I'd be long gone by now, Verci said. And I wouldn't have left my gear with a front man.
Fair enough, she said. So you passed well enough to get to see me?
A test, Asti shouted.
Don't you scream at me, Asti Rynax, she snapped. You come to me after years, years since you decided to cut out on me and go straight. Your brother had the decency to go straight honestly, telling me to my face that he was out of the business, but you...
What about me, Josie?
There's going straight and going square.
I ain't square, Asti said.
That's the word out there, she said. Could be a nice cover. Asti Rynax gets kicked out of Druth Intelligence and worms his way back into the old business. Gets in good and deep.
That's not it, Verci said. That's not it at all.
So you say.
She pointed to a cupboard.
Get a bottle of wine from there and pour us some glasses.
Verci went over to get the wine. Asti sat down at the table, leaning into Josie.
You don't trust me, fine. Trust him.
When it comes to you?
She shook her head.
Not hardly. He'd walk through fire for you.
Already did tonight,
Verci said. He brought the wine over and poured out three glasses.
You said some noise about a fire up there. What happened?
Holver Alley. The whole thing burned down on the east side. Our shop, Greenfield shop, everything in between.
Josie whistled low and sipped at her wine. Asti picked up his glass and sniffed at it.
Problem, Asti?
She asked.
Something wrong with the wine?
Not sure, he said. I'm trying to decide if you're paranoid enough to keep a cabinet full of poisoned wine, dosing yourself with the antidote every day so you can casually offer the wine to someone who comes down here.
I am,
she said, sipping her wine again.
I got pinched and thrown in Quarrygate once. That was plenty. But if I wanted you dead, you wouldn't have even made it in here.
When's the last time you saw sunlight, Josie?
I've got safe houses with windows, she said. I've even got a nice little garden in one.
Charming, Asti said.
Quiet,
she said.
All right, Asti, drink it.
Pardon?
Drink the wine, Asti, or get out.
Verci had enough of this game.
He picked up his glass and drank down the wine in one gulp. Asti shrugged and did the same.
Can we do some business now? Verci asked.
Well, boys, that depends on what your business is. Who do I have here, a disgraced ex-spy and a married shopkeeper? Or do I have the Rynax boys?
Josie, we've lost just about everything, Verci said.
And I need to know why you're here. Are you two locals standing with hat in hand for a loan, or are you the sons of Kelsey Rynax coming to me to get a gig?
Verci looked over to Asti. He would rather just go for the loan. He'd hoped Asti would feel the same way. He saw the look in Asti's eye. Asti was here for the gig.
You want to get back into the business?
No, Asti said. But what the blazes else can we do? We've tried other things, brother. But this is what we've been bred for. This is our blood.
Touching, Asti, Josie said. Bit smart. If I'm right, you boys already have a debt to old Spence for the shop. Adding a loan at my rates would break your backs.
Verci stared at the empty glass. He didn't like this. He didn't want to go back to it. Rach didn't want him to either. Rach and Corsi needed a home and money too. Food on the table. Josie was right, no matter how much he didn't want her to be. A few good gigs, they could rebuild the shop, get back on course.
Only slip and grab jobs though, Verci said. From cats who can take the hit. No blood runs, no hasper or drug deals of any kind.
I don't do those kinds of deals, Josie said. Those have moved to the big dogs.
We won't do them, Verci said.
Fair enough, she said. I may have something for you.
All right,
Asti said. She got up from her chair and hobbled over to a desk in the corner. She took out a small pouch and tossed it over to Asti.
20 crowns, as an advance.
What's the gig?
I'll send word with details. I'll be hooking you up with a carriage man to work it.
This a 3-man job?
Don't know for sure, she said. That's what you do, Asti. You size up the job and figure out what you need. But I've got a carriage man I want to check out. He's swaddling, but he's eager.
You want us to try new blood? Verci asked.
You're the boys who need the work, she said. You take what I got or find someone else who'll even talk to you. I'm only doing it because I feel a little nostalgic about your father.
We appreciate it, Asti said.
I'll send him to you at Kimber's around 6 bells tomorrow evening.
How we know him?
He'll say I sent him, she said flatly. Oh, and he's Chumik, so you can't miss him.
Verci was surprised to hear that. Josie Holt usually didn't use talent that stood out in a crowd.
We'll see him tomorrow then, Verci said.
How do we get out of here? Holt lifted her cane and hooked a wall-mounted lamp near her desk. A hidden door swung open next to her.
No traps in this one? Asti asked.
You tell me, she said with a smile.
The two of them went to the door. She stopped them just before they went in.
Boys, I am sorry about the alley and your shop. We'll get you on your feet quick, all right?
She smiled warmly for the first time.
Thanks, Verci said.
We at least could come to you, Asti said. There's a lot of folks who don't have that option.
All right, get, she said. I've had enough of the both of you.
They went into the passage and the door closed behind them. A moment later, another door opened in front of them, a powerful stench coming in with it.
Sewer exit, Asti said.
Lovely.
That way about 1/2 mile, Verci said, pointing down the passage. We come out of the creek.
Asti held his breath for 5 disgusting minutes until they were back in the open air, wading in Shell Creek, which marked the line between the neighbourhoods of Seleth and Keller Cove. Asti breathed deep and looked around. Their packs were hanging on a hook above the sewer entrance.
Isn't that thoughtful? Asti said.
She thinks of everything,
Verci said. He climbed up and took their packs while Asti got out of the creek. He threw Asti's pack to him and stripped out of his sewer-stained clothes.
I'm running out of clothing, Asti said as he took his own off.
Give those to me. I'll bring them to the laundry girl on Kenner in the morning.
Where are you going now?
Verci asked.
I'm going to Kimber's, Asti said.
He took a few coins out of the purse and tossed it over to Verci. You're going to Rach's sister's place.
You could come too, Verci said.
I barely get along with Rach, let alone her sister, Asti said.
That flop is going to be crowded enough.
You sure?
Get your wife, brother.
He pulled on his last clean pair of trousers. Verci started up the embankment.
I'm not happy with this, you know.
Asti didn't know what to make of that. What the blazes is there to be happy about?
Nothing, Verci snapped. I mean, I understand, all right. We're in a bind. We go to Josie. We get a gig. We get on our feet. But that's it, right?
Are you asking me if we're going back for good? Asti did his best to smile, put on a good face for Verci. Not on your life.
Not on Corsi's life, you get it?
Verci said. Asti got it plenty. Dad had never given either of them much choice, putting them to work almost as soon as they could walk. Verci was adamant about never doing that to his son.
You'll raise him clean, Asti said. I'd die before I let otherwise happen.
Don't talk like that.
Asti waved him off. I'll see you at Six Bells tomorrow, all right?
All right, Verci said. You're going to be well, yes?
I'm fine, brother, Asti said.
It came out shorter than he meant. He knew what Verci was hinting at, but didn't want to talk about when he'd lost control.
Fine, Verci said. Tomorrow, then.
He went off down the dark street. Asti went the other way, up Frost, until he reached Kimber's pub. Despite the late hour, the lamps were still lit out front. Asti found the taproom filled with people. Most of them were from the alley, smeared with ash. Eyes red from smoke or tears. The worst off were laid out on the tables, and Doc Gelson, looking weary and broken, was going around checking the injured. Others were curled up on the floor, wherever there was space. Helen and Julian were up against one wall. Near a table with Winthim Greenfield sleeping on it, Asti started his way over to them.
Asti.
A soft hand touched him on the arm. Kimber, her warm round face filled with big sad eyes.
You're hurt.
His arms were covered in scrapes and cuts, red welts from the burns.
It's not much.
He pulled his arm away.
Let's get Gelson to look at it, she said. I heard you and your brother, you went in there for Wynne.
Went in there for all of them, only got Wynne.
But you went in, she said. Where's Verci and his wife?
Rach has a sister, lives a few blocks from here. They went over there.
And you came here?
Asti held up a coin. I can pay for a room. She put her hands over his.
No rooms left, just floor if you can find space, and I'm not charging anyone for that.
She beckoned Doc Gelson.
You just take care of yourself right now, all right?
Yes, ma'am. She went off as Gelson approached, stinking of cider. Despite that, his hands looked steady and his eyes were focused.
Rynax, he said. You really were in the thick of it, eh? Took you a while to get over here.
Had to take care of things. Things.
Gelson scowled and took Asti's arm.
Burns aren't too bad. These are knife wounds.
Taking care of things, Asti said.
There's something we need to tell the constabulary.
Are there any around to tell?
Gelson shook his head and clucked his tongue.
These aren't so bad as to need stitching. I'll dress the whole arm, burns and cuts.
A bunch of punks thought they could take advantage. Had to educate them otherwise.
Wasn't that long ago Rynax boys would have been the ones taking advantage.
Asti resisted the urge to yank his arm away. If Gelson wanted to run his drunk mouth off while patching him, let the man.
Good,
Gelson said once he finished wrapping the arm.
Keep it dry, change the dressing tomorrow night, keep out of trouble, the whole drill.
Whole drill,
Asti whispered.
You're welcome.
Gelson stumbled off. Asti crossed to the far corner and slumped down by Helen and Julian. In the light, the two of them looked even worse for wear. Helen had taken the pins out of her hair, letting it fall to her shoulders, but it was still a mess of tangles and ash. Julian's short hair was even worse, as a huge chunk on his left side had been burned off.
What's the word?
Asti asked, nodding at Wynne's sleeping body.
He woke up for a bit,
Helen said distantly, her green eyes glazed over.
Doc says he took a lot of smoke, but he'll be all right.
Did you tell him about his family?
Yeah,
Helen said. Her voice cracked. Asti had never seen anything choke Helen up before. She was the toughest bird he'd ever known.
It was the first thing he asked.
I'm sorry about that, Hel, he said.
Yeah, well, she said. I was here when he asked. What else could I do?
Jules,
Asti asked. How are you doing?
Got no home, Asti.
Julian croaked out.
Where is Helen going to live? Where am I?
Don't know yet, Julian, Asti said. We're all trying to figure that out.
He glanced back at Helen.
lowering his voice. You have anything set aside?
Nah,
Helen said.
And where would we have set it?
Wasn't for having that house from our gram. We'd have been flat out a long time ago.
You're not working,
he whispered to her.
Not the jobs I want,
she said. She locked eyes with Asti. Nobody wants to give us a gig, not since Holtman's.
That wasn't your fault,
Asti said. It was Julian's, she said. We both know it. She looked over at Julian, who was sitting with his massive legs curled up close to his body. For a moment, Asti thought he looked like a giant child.
What about bare-knuckle bouts?
Asti asked. Jules could do well enough.
No chance, she said.
Her eyes flamed up. She turned away, looking off in the distance again. Last thing his head needs is taking a few more shots. Asti didn't reply. Julian was far from the brightest guy on the block. After he had taken a beating from a gang from Benson Court, he had never recovered. Julian's memory wasn't the same after that. His cousin did her best to take care of him. It was a shame no one would hire her either. Asti didn't know anyone better with a crossbow.
I guess you didn't manage a room upstairs, he said.
Full up already, Helen said. Kimber told everyone they were welcome to stay the night in the tap room. Asti looked around the room. Nearly every spare spot to lie or sit was filled with someone. Plenty of people hurt or broken. Plenty more curled up and sleeping wherever they found space. There were faces Asti knew, like Ullman and Ellie Hansper, dozing against the wall with their four children asleep in their laps. There were other faces he didn't, like the dark-haired waif girl, barely 16, looking like she hadn't had a proper meal in weeks. He turned back to Helen.
Has anyone official come through here?
Official how? Constabulary, fire brigade, yellow shields, or the neighbourhood council, if not the aldermen?
Someone from the Duke of Maradaine? Anyone?
He was agitated, and his question was louder than he had meant for it to be. The dark-haired girl, sitting in the shadow of the bar, answered.
Brigade showed up to temp it out eventually. Just one water wagon after most of the alley had burned out. A couple constabs were around the alley telling folks to get out of there, but they didn't say any more than that. Certainly didn't do more.
Ain't nobody official going to help us,
Helen said. We look out for each other then, Julian said, half asleep. Asti nodded. He wanted to go around, find out more about what happened, what people were doing, but exhaustion had set in. Sitting down on the wooden floor, he could barely keep his eyes open. Closing them, he surrendered to sleep. Chapter 3 Verci had been asleep for several hours when the prod of someone's foot woke him up. He opened his eyes just enough to determine the identity of the prodder. It was Hal, Rach's sister's prat of a husband. Hal was a lumbering, puffy man, with what little hair he had pulled back by running his greasy, sweaty fingers through it.
Why are you sleeping on the floor?
Hal asked.
Once I got in here, couldn't take another step, Verci said.
He really hadn't planned to fall asleep on the floor of the cloakroom of Rach's sister's house. He just dropped down as soon as he got in.
Didn't want to wake anyone. Rach upstairs.
How'd you get in?
Hal waddled over to the front door.
I thought I'd locked it.
Not much of a lock, Verci mumbled.
Hal glanced back at Verci, his face confused. He shook it away after a moment.
Well, Rach was a wreck when she got here, I'll tell you that.
He breathed heavy, rubbing his sweaty head.
It sounds like you all had quite the night.
We lost our home, Hal, Verci said.
Yeah,
Hal said, nodding.
Real terrible. But you were just renting that, Verci. What about the shop?
Shop was lost as well, Verci said. We lost everything.
That's just terrible,
Hal said, shaking his head some more. Verci had had enough conversations with the man to know this was the limit of Hal's sympathy.
Well, you know, you and Rach, of course, take a day or two, figure out what you're going to do.
That's very kind of you, Hal, Verci said flatly.
You'll work it out,
Hal said, looking more at the floor and walls than Verci.
You were, I always said. You were so clever with your bits and gears and twisty things. Clever one, yeah.
Where is Rach, Hal?
Oh, she and Leanne are in the kitchen, of course,
Hal said.
You better go let her know you're here, because she's still a frightful wreck. I need to get to work, of course.
Of course, Verci said.
Hal was a clerk for one of the exchange and import houses near the river docks of Keller Cove. This was what Rach's sister would often call a proper, respectable job.
Yeah, it's just, well...
Hal hesitated.
You're on my cloak.
Oh, Verci said, getting up. He had no memory of taking the cloak off its hook and lying down on it. He had been dead exhausted when he came in. He picked up the cloak, lamely dusting it off and handing it to Hal. Sorry about that.
No problem,
Hal said.
You've, you know, been through a lot.
He sniffed at the cloak and then sniffed at Verci.
Did you fall in the sewers or something?
Something.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.